privilege to introduce our speaker tonight, Jessica Reznicek, a member of the Des Moines Catholic Worker Community, which was founded in 1976 in response to the call to compassionate action, committed to a simple, nonviolent lifestyle, living and working among the poor. While the Catholic Worker Community serves residents of Des Moines day in and day out, they also engage in important activities advocating social justice. Jessica has been a part of the Rachel Corey Project, doing peace and justice work in Palestine. There she was arrested by Israeli soldiers along with other activists and Palestinian farmers, planting olive trees on their own property. She has joined peace activists in South Korea, attempting to halt construction of a major U.S. naval base there. She was a part of Occupy Wall Street in New York and in Iowa, and has worked on other social justice and environmental issues at home and in other states. I met Jessica near Montrose, Iowa, on the day she put down her rug and decided to stay. To camp, to repeatedly block access to construction of the Dakota Access Pipeline at the site where they were drilling under the Mississippi. This simple action led to the Mississippi Stand encampment, subsequent actions, and efforts to halt arrests, and as others joined in the effort to protect our water here and downstream. She's continued her efforts to halt extraction and transport of fossil fuels, to keep it in the ground, to kill the black snake in Arkansas and in other states. I'll let her speak for herself. My friend Jessica Reznicek.
Jeez, how did you know that much about me? I'm not proud of that.
You read as a lecture.
Wow, you're paying attention. Okay, well, I'm really, really honored to be here today, mostly because I looked up to all of you through this whole process. The grannies were the first to arrive on the scene when I first laid that map down, and I was so frustrated, and I didn't know where to go, and I didn't know what to do, and you calmed me down, you soothed me, and you said, okay, people are coming. And I said, oh, they are? And you came back, and you kept coming back, and you brought people with you, and I appreciate that, and I'm really grown in so many relationships closely with so many of you folks here today. It's how I met my comrade Ruby, who now lives in my house and is a fellow supporter of the Catholic, Des Moines Catholic Worker, and we've moved on strongly together. And without you all having been there from that first moment, it's hard to say what, you know, you saw me. I was irrational. So, and desperate, because these are desperate times that we're in, and you felt that desperation, and you felt it in me, and you felt it in yourself, and that's somehow your desperation calmed me down. Okay, so I'm sorry. But so I'm here today, and I know that so many of you have so many much superior stories, but so it's an honor to be here telling you mine, and so I really appreciate that. And really, honestly, I hate public speaking. I abhor it, and so I'm horrible at it, and I get very nervous. And it's funny that you all wrote me into this. Only the grannies could. And when I agreed to it, however, 6 months ago, when you proposed it to me, I really thought that by now I would be in jail or prison. I didn't think that I would actually be around and available to do this talk. But here I am. And I'm glad to be here despite my anxiety. I was telling somebody before the talk today, it's interesting that I discovered this about myself, this anxiety around public speaking over the years, because I would do international peace work and I'd bring back photos and PowerPoints, and it's just an obligation as an activist in this realm to tell your story and to tell that story of people who don't have voices. And or at least they do, but not heard. And I realized about myself, like, geez, I'm more anxious talking in front of a crowd about a war zone than actually being in one. And this is ridiculous. Like, I just need to get over it and tell my story and tell it well as I can, and tell the stories of others who aren't able to do so. And so here I am today. And we could do this one of two ways. I could kind of give you, I could give you a background of like my activist or whatever you want, activist, protester, water protector, you know, with those, all, you can call me whatever you want. I'm just a human being and I'm doing the best I can. So I can kind of tell you, give you some background, or we can do a question and answer if there are specifics that folks want to talk about.
Let's do both.
Okay. I'm going to give you a little bit of a background about how I became a fighter for social justice, environmental justice, and all justices I could find. It started when I was young. I was about 12 years old, and at that time they just called me a criminal. I thought, oh, I'm just a juvenile delinquent. I didn't know that actually I was standing up for something, because, you know, all those authorities, they start telling you, oh, no, you're not supposed to do this, you're not supposed to do that. But I used to walk past the we call them sale, I'm from rural Iowa, sale barn, where they sell the cattle and everything. We walk past that every day on the way to school, and I see all those cows in there, and I was like, oh my gosh, these poor cows, and they're mowing. And so one day I broke into that sale barn, 12 years old, and I broke all of the locks off and let them all run free. And of course, the school is right across the street, and so I just went to school like, and I remember sitting in my math class. Oh, I never was good at math anyway. I never paid attention. You know, and no matter how many times you add it up, things just don't add up. You know, but I remember I was sitting, and there was a window, and all the cows were grazing on the lawn of the school, and I was like, run away! I'm like, just run away! Like, what are you doing? You know? And so then Anderson at the time was my married name. Jessica Anderson called me to the office, you know. And so then you had to complain. Well, like, yeah, like that was me, and then I had to do, you know, you had to go to the JIT, and then you see the community service and everything, and everybody just like, this is a problem child, you know, this is a problem child. And you know, not until I met the Catholic Workers, the organization to which I belong now, did I really connect the dots that all along I've been this person. Like this person who would commit a smaller crime to prevent a greater one from happening, as the defense that the grannies are using right now in their trial. I'm okay with taking that risk, you know? And heck, I eat meat. I just felt bad for those cows, you know what I mean? Like, they needed to be free. And I continued to move on, you know? I petitioned to allow girls to play football in junior high, and I petitioned to allow rollerblading, you know, on public sidewalks, you know? I mean, this is all, like, just as... I remember, you know, all throughout high school, I never really quite fit in anywhere, and at the same time, I kind of still fit in everywhere. It was a strange just world that I've always managed to exist in. And most of my friends were dropouts. I stayed in and said no. I excelled academically. I was always good at it, but I never felt like the institution of education really held much integrity for me. I was like, oh, they want this answer? Okay, I'll give them this. But I can remember, you know, all of my friends were you know, partying out. We had this trestle outside of town, and we'd all go out there to the sandbar and party, and we'd hang out there all night. And in the morning, I was the only one to go back to school. I'm like, yeah, y'all are coming back? Okay. Well, I'm going back to school, and I'd show up, and I wouldn't have shoes on. I had sand in my toes and no shoes on my feet. And I'm like, I'm here for school. And they said, Jessica, you have to have shoes to come into the school. And I thought, well, I'm here. I'm here to learn. And I never really quite fit in anywhere. I went and I thought, okay, well, you're not going to allow me to receive my education because I'm not playing by your rules. Okay, I'll go find my shoes at the sandbar, come back, you know. And that's just always how it's been. And I think, you know, I graduated my junior year. I moved out. I did some community college off and on for years. And in all of that, I think, you know, you're just suppressing who you really are because you just haven't found your people. You know, you just haven't found the people who will accept you for who you are and say, no, you know, it's okay to go throw some tires out in front of that road and say, this isn't right. And not only do that, but commend you for it. It's a crazy little tribe I found, and you all are a part of it. Vets for Peace, I see, is represented here tonight, and geez, how much legitimacy has Vets for Peace brought to everything I do. When I go to South Korea and say we don't want a naval base here, they just look at me like, who are you? You don't matter. But then when Vets for Peace says, oh, we funded her and sent her, oh, okay, you know, and thank God for you folks, you know, thank God for my having found you, and for you bringing me, you know, legitimacy to what I'm doing and who I am as a human being. You know, I finished community college with a 2-year degree. I got an academic scholarship to a 4-year institution, and I chose Simpson College. And I went to Simpson, and true to my spirit, I used to hide all of this because I was embarrassed, but now, you know, you just embrace it as you go. True to my spirit, I was kicked out of the college. And I'm kicked out of everywhere I go, it seems, but I always do so cordially, I believe, but, you know, I was studying history and political science. I was a double major there, and it's a good school. It's a good school. I'm great. Academic advisors, I got along with them so well, and I was older than most of the students, and so I absorbed that information with a little bit different light, due to experience, which is light, you know, and I remember reading the materials they'd give me, and I would just, you know, page turners, like, oh my gosh, this is happening in the world, you know, you always kind of feel like something's not right and things aren't adding up, but when you really, somebody hands you the material and says, here, research this and write a paper about it, and we're talking about, you know, political systems globally and how the U.S. is just stomping around, I mean, just line for line, the U.S. is stomping around this entire world and killing people for profit, and so I'm reading this, and I'm like, well, what am I supposed to do with this? I can't just read this and then pass my test and go on with my life. This supports action. You know, somebody must stand up. And so I started organizing on campus. And this was right around the time of Occupy Wall Street, still before I'd really met my tribe of folks who had given me that affirmation. You know what I mean? So I'm running around, much like I was down at the Mississippi River when you all encounter me, like, oh my gosh, there's this horrible thing happening in the world and nobody's paying attention. And so I started organizing campus, and I was stomping around, and I was yelling, and I was passing out flyers, and I was manic, and the dean called me in, and he says, you know, we decided that you're a danger to yourself and to others. And I thought, what? I said, well, I'm a danger. Well, have you been paying attention to what our government's been doing? And so, you know, and I remember years after that, I said, okay, this is right when Occupy Wall Street kind of started happening. I said, okay, you know, I have better things to do anyway. And I went to New York and camped out at Zuccotti Park for several weeks. And I used to be like, oh my gosh, you know, that's really bad. The dean of my school, you know, out of school, you know, basically for being way too overly passionate and not focusing on the curriculum, but focusing on the big picture and what we need to do once we learned these things, and now I'm, you know, I say, oh yeah, I studied at Simpson because I never actually got a degree, but now, you know, I just embrace it. You know, I get kicked out of a lot of places, and that's okay. When I'm in jail, the women tell me, oh, you know, I got kicked out of this bar and that pawn shop. I was like, yeah, I get kicked out of countries. Get kicked out of countries, schools, everything. You know, so I've just learned to be like, you know what, this is who I am, and I speak my mind, and I'm going to be persistent, and I'm going to continue to speak it, and I'm going to continue to speak, do it so with love and compassion, and I think that that's the only way that we can be in this world, if that's who we're meant to be. And so here I am today. Well, after Occupy Wall Street, I got a phone call from my cousin. I was out in New York, and just gone through this kind of tumultuous experience of getting kicked out of my college. Like, oh, what am I going to do? You know, what am I doing? And I received a phone call that there is all sorts of activism happening at the Iowa State Capitol, which is, you know, that's my stomping ground. And I thought, well, I'm coming back home. You know, if there are people at home, I'm going to find them, and I'm not going to let them go. They're going to be my people. And at the forefront of that movement were the Des Moines Catholic Workers and the Veterans for Peace. They were doing the dishes, providing the food. They were on the front lines of every mass civil disobedience that happened during the Occupy Wall Street, we called it Occupy Des Moines. We kind of owned it in our local city. It happened to overlap with the presidential caucuses, and so we occupied every presidential campaign office. We shut many of them down successfully. They literally relocated and changed their phone numbers. They were so fearful of us. But you know, I kept seeing a common denominator. It was like Catholic workers are the people who were like, I'm not leaving. You know, I said, who are these folks? Because I really need to get to know them better. And so I started going to the house and talk about, they were not only speaking a lifestyle, they were living it day in and day out. And I got to know who they were and what they were about and said, I want this. This is what I want. And we run a soup kitchen 5 days a week, two meals a day out of those 5 days. And we provide showers, services, food. We do various food deliveries. We do food giveaways. We are basically the champions of dumpster diving, like you've never seen it before. We literally we rescue nine altogether, cargo vans full of food from going into the dumpster a week. And redistribute it to the poor and use it to cook food. We live off of it as well as everybody in our neighborhood. I know Mary Beth's been to our neck of the woods, and this is where the people live on the streets. They sleep out in front of the house. Sometimes they sleep on the porch if it's rainy. We do the best we can. As Frank Cordero says, some of you know him, we do noble and heroic work, but we are not necessarily noble and heroic people. It's a perfect line, and it's so true. We just do the best we can. But what was more attractive to me at the time when I first entered was the social justice component of the Catholic worker and the space that was provided for folks who really want to take on the fight and take it on full time and can put themselves in spaces that aren't necessarily as risky for the average person. I don't own a home. They provide a home for me. I can't lose my home. I don't pay my fines. Complete non-cooperation with the state in terms of like paying them any money. I can do that. Most people can't. They'll come after your home. They'll come after your car. They'll come after your... And so that then... find yourself in a space a space where you are afforded the ability to live that way, you then have an obligation to live that way. And so I think when most people see me like, dang, you know, that girl over there, she just got arrested like 12 times this year. Well, yeah, okay, I did, but I'm really in a space where that demands it. I can't just sit idly by and say, oh boy, I'm pretty comfortable here. I don't have any worries. And let the rest of the world just melt away. I think every individual who's joined that worker community knows that they have an obligation now to act and act now and not let even a moment go by. Last year at this time, I was sitting in Sarpy County Jail, Nebraska, facing two felonies, 22 years in prison. And I can't believe I'm here today. I wasn't meant to be. I used the necessity defense. It didn't work out that well. but I did get the charges dropped down to what they should have been, because it's notorious for what our criminal justice system does is they jack up these charges. We all get very afraid and we want to comply. And I'm in a situation where I can say, no, I'm going to call your bluff and I'm going to keep moving. And then the day before my trial last year in June, I believe it was, they dropped the charges down and set me free. And And then I knew that whole time sitting in jail, I was jogging my cell and I was thinking about the pipeline the whole time. You know, I should have been thinking about my 22 years that I was looking at. But I was just like, I knew y'all were out there working on it already because I got a report, you know, there's this 100 grannies, you know, they're really, and there's this other group and this other group. And I know there was a lot of focus on the Des Moines River and the camp was starting to really take off up in North Dakota. And I'm just, I gotta get in on that. So it was just really, I got out there a little late because you all really had a really good thing going up in Des Moines, and you did it sustained for quite some time, which is why I went down to the Mississippi, because it really seemed like you had it on lockdown up there. I still look at the pipeline and think it's not over. I refuse. You know, the Dakota Access. It's one of my roles at, we called it the ditch camp down at the Mississippi. One of the roles of the ditch camp when I was occupying that space and calling for more people to come there, one of my initial roles was like, don't come here and say, I hope we can stop it, or I really want to stop it, or I'm going to do my best to stop it. We are going to stop it. Because they continue on in their arrogance every day saying, we will build this pipeline. And that's how they do it. I mean, we need to start taking it back. We will stop it. And I'm not letting go of it. It will be stopped. And they're scheduling the oil to be running through it any time now. Folks, I'm not giving up. And I will never. And even if that, and it's just like when we said when the camp disbanded down there, even when that oil's flowing through it, there are valves to be shut off. There are steps to take, and I will not give up. I will not give up. And I think it's just a shift in that mentality for myself personally, because it really can seem very overwhelming when you look at what we're up against. But really, I mean, the passion that was displayed down there, and the energy, and the risk, and the sacrifice that so many folks made, hundreds and hundreds of folks made, in big ways, in huge ways, in whatever ways they could, each individual could, and that to me is a testimony to what we're willing to give to make sure that things are done the right way. And so that's kind of a brief rundown. There's lots of stuff in between that we can talk about.
Hunger strike.
The hunger strike. Another moment of desperation, yeah.
When nobody talked to you out of it.
Yeah, so the backstory to that was when the grannies came down. I showed up at the Mississippi bore site, built a blockade, got arrested, walked back from the jail, built another blockade when they let me out, got arrested, walked back from the jail, built a third blockade, I believe it was, got arrested, went to jail. And at that point, I think Frank Cordero was down, and the grannies met me, because I was like, I'm going back, you know? And Frank had started spreading the word up here in Iowa City at one of your meetings. And I was just, I remember just pacing back and forth and said, something must be done. Something, I have to do something. There's something more I can do. And I was convinced there until I talked to you all that I was going to go on a hunger strike at the entrance of that bore site. No food, no water. I was done. I'm like, this is
in early September.
I wouldn't have lasted a day. No water. I mean, I was convinced that they were going to find a dead woman that they're going to have to walk by every day. So the granny said, look, people are coming. We just heard about this next weekend. And there was a Mr. I don't know, a lot of you folks met a Mr. Huey Tweedy down there, who pulled me aside, and he told me his story. Because he hit that moment. He saw it in my eyes when they were trying to clear cut his land down in Lee County, Iowa. Dakota Access was attempting to clear cut his land. And he told me his story, and I won't repeat it because it's his story. His to tell, but he said, we need you strong, we need you here, and he was prepared to support me in whatever way possible. And the grannies came, and they were just, y'all were just like, no, we can't do this. Everybody was getting very nervous. So I acquiesced, and I said, okay, I'll wait here, and I put my rug down, like Aaron was speaking to me, and I called for more folks to come, and they came. People came. Lots of people came, and it was a glorious moment when it happened. So fast forward, a lot of people came, the resistance was strong. We'd received word that the boring had been completed under the Mississippi. The camp pretty much disbanded. I went back to Des Moines and realized that right here in my home city was the Iowa Utilities Board meeting hall. And I was like, these are the folks that really need, these are the folks who can sign the papers and make this go away. You know, in my mind, if I can't stop construction on a corporate level, then I'm gonna go after our officials, our appointed officials by, I wouldn't say elected, but our appointed officials by Governor Terry Branson. And I went back to that desperate moment and desperate measures and decided to do an open-ended fast, demanding that the permits be revoked to allow Dakota Access to continue moving forward. And Ruby was my key support person there during that time, and I know that a lot of you came down and visited and supported. I did do a liquid-only fast. I did coconut water and water, I believe, are my two. Yeah, my two. And I went 2 weeks, and on the 14th day, we received word that Obama had revoked the permits up in North Dakota. And in all honesty, if we're going to be honest, that was my way out. I was like, if there's not going to be a better moment for me to get out of an open-ended fast than this one. And decided at least that would buy us some time. The statement would be done. I wanted to believe, or the survey would be done, and perhaps things were starting to go our way. And went home and began eating again and contemplated whether I should go up to North Dakota. In this kind of weather, am I just a liability up there? Can I be supportive up there? So 14 days of an occupation outside of the Iowa Utilities Board. I was out in front of, I'd be out in front of their sign during the day and then back behind during the evening, and a 24-hour watch. And I don't know if all you met Travis. He was my sidekick at the time. After, I think, 6 or 7 days, he said, he was such a wonderful, dear person. I dropped him off down in Louisiana a little while back, in the swamp, per his request. He's a strange person. Just drop me off here. Oh, up here? But he was a dear heart who stayed there with me through the whole thing. And about 6 or 7 days into it, he came up to me very, I think that he realized really what he'd signed up for, and the fear was in his eyes, and he said, I don't want to die, you know. And I said, Travis, then don't. Eats food. He said, oh, okay, you know. And he started drinking the protein shakes and eating. But I think I would have sat out there alone, and I would have done it alone, but I know it was all the visits from folks like you and from that commitment from Travis, a kid I didn't even know. I mean, I never knew this kid, and this is commitment to the cause. And to that non-violent, self-sacrificial form of resistance was just so pure and on point that this made sense to him. And even if he couldn't do it, it made sense to be with somebody who was doing it. You know what I mean? And he'd play guitar for me, and we'd sit up there, and we had one of the women who is now moved into the Catholic Worker and is a Catholic Worker. Her name is Sarah. She was also a student at Simpson and had never before met anybody who actively resisted anything. She'd only through Facebook, social, whatever y'all call it. And she's like, I've never really actually met a person in my city who's done this. I was like, yeah. And I said, you should go check out the Catholic Workers. And now there she is. She's moved in. She's entering an internship, and is very eager to begin resistance herself. And if nothing else, we got Sarah. You know, if nothing else, we got Sarah. So.
Did you ever achieve the goal of actually being able to talk to any of those three IUD members?
I
know there were several meetings that you attempted to join.
Oh yeah, I did get arrested in there at one point. Jerry Hoosier. It's a small town and I could identify her, and so she had to come in and out of work, and I would make attempts, and I was careful to not follow her out to her car or do anything. But I did. She never did allow a meeting, but there were those moments of like humanity where she was coming in and out of work, and I would say, honestly, from the bottom of my heart, because she would never look at me, you know, because she was ashamed and she knew what she was doing, I believe. And I'd say to her, you know, Jerry, I know that you're a good woman. Do the right thing. Do the right thing, Jerry.
She tried.
Yeah, she did.
She was the only one of the three that tried to do the right thing at one point.
There were other folks who ended up doing one of them ended up doing a little documentary on me. Another employee there. It was very personal, which made people uncomfortable. And that's really, I just wrote an article for the Via Pace, which is our newsletter out of the Catholic Worker, and the title of it is Uncomfortable. And that's really where we've got to get people in this culture, in this society that we've created. There's just so much comfort that we aren't really called upon to look at what we're doing and the consequences of what we're doing, because we live in these comfortable little worlds, and it made people very uncomfortable, and that was the goal. When they saw me there day after day and like committed to something that was greater than me, it made them very uncomfortable. And in small ways, I think, you know, they probably went home thinking about it, and that was the goal.
Would you say some more about when you tried using the necessity defense? Because
sure.
Wednesday, those of us who are facing trial are aiming for that.
Yeah, great. So super excited when I heard that you all were using that. I know Mary Beth knows because I told her. I'm so excited. Because I've said this before to a few of you, but I think like if we are going to be fighting these battles in our justice systems, from what little I know, but from what I know, this is the defense that's going to do it, and it has been done before, and there are wins. It's very rare, but there are. So I'll set up my situation. After I became involved at the Catholic Worker, there was a Rachel Corey project, was an international peace project that I helped to co-found. And basically what we did was we would go to international war zones and provide third-party nonviolent third-party accompaniment work. Now I can go on and on about that, but the main thing that I want to talk about is that through my activism in war zones, I saw a lot of just atrocities, bloodshed, violence, oppression by the state, weapons, kidnappings, arrests, torture, and due to those experiences, I was offered 2 years ago a research grant to research the top 10 defense contractors operating in Omaha in conjunction with STRATCOM, Strategic Air Command. And as we know from my Simpson, my Simpson College escape, I researched, and then once I learned about these weapon systems and how they were operating right out of Omaha, the same weapon systems that were killing my friends in the West Bank, it was a time for action. No, you know, researcher, like, I'm not so much a researcher as I am an activist, okay? So I took that research and the information that I learned in my neighboring city and where these weapon systems are being manufactured and practiced and bought and sold. And I, one evening, went to one of the defense contractors. The name is Northrop Grumman. And I took my baseball bat and my sledgehammer, and I broke out the windows of this building, entered it with the intention to break all of the stuff in that office. And it didn't go that way because I entered the building. When I entered the building, there was a secured entry door. I didn't have the key card. So there I was. But all the same, I could go on and on about that, but I was arrested that night with two felony charges. Burglary and criminal mischief, facing 22 years. And this was in January of last year. And I was so wound up when I got in front of that judge that first morning, the following day. And I said, I'm not paying you any money. You set the bond at whatever you want. Well, $100,000. Okay. But those words later. And I also said, he said, well, would you like to have a defense counsel? And I said, no. I said, none of your people have ever done anything for me. I'll defend myself. Boy, I eat those words later too. So I was defending myself against 22 years in prison in a county I'd never been in a state I wasn't a resident of. And I decided the next day after I calmed down, I was like, I'm in some big trouble. I've gotten myself into some big trouble. And I was like, okay, because along with my activist journey has also been one of faith. And as long as I knew that I was acting in accordance with my conscience, that I was going to be all right. But luckily, I had people who loved me and cared about me, and I started making phone calls and said, okay, so I'm going to try to defend myself against these two felonies here, and I'm going to do it from jail because I'm not bailing out. Okay. So, and let me tell you, the criminal law books available to you in jail are not up to date or plentiful. And so I thought, okay, so where do I start from? So luckily I had some friends who put me in contact with this man, Mr. Bill Quigley, down in New Orleans. He's a federal attorney who specializes in what's called the theory of defense. It's also called necessity defense. It's called different things in different statutes in different states, but it's all basically summarize the idea of it is just what I was speaking to earlier, which was I've committed a smaller crime. I admit it. I did it. You know, I'm not trying to. I broke those windows. But I broke those windows and I entered that building to prevent a larger crime from occurring, which is you know, blasting your drone shots at my friend's kids in the West Bank. So that's the whole, that's kind of like the premise of necessity defense. And in that process, I learned a lot. Jeez, I learned a lot. I learned how to file motions. I learned how, I grew up the prosecutor from my jail cell every day. Just tormented the lady. But there are certain things. One I learned is not, the judge did not even allow the defense to be used. And that's the biggest hurdle. If you can convince the judge that this is basically that there is probable cause for the judge to believe that that you have a leg to stand on, the judge will allow it. But the main reason the judge did not allow it to be used in my trial is because the prosecutor maintained that there was not an imminent threat. Okay, posed. I'm sure you're going to come up against that. An imminent threat posed. So basically, I couldn't prove that my bashing their computer systems was going to prevent a drone strike from happening imminently. And despite all of the urgency that we feel about these things, one action does not prevent necessarily the second action from occurring. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay. And that's typically what trips most defendants up and doesn't allow the defense to be brought to trial. And that was so in my case. The defense that I had created was that this company is in violation of all sorts of international law, be it the Geneva Conventions, the UN sanctions, you know, the list goes on and on. And they are in violation of all of these, as well as domestic law, because the U.S., because the U.S. is supposed to be following international law. So you are in violation of law, both domestic and international law. So despite all of the information that I prepared and all of the stuff that I brought to the table, the main thing that prevented me from being allowed to use that defense was a lack of imminent threat. However, I did have a judge, and because I think this is partially because I was defending myself, but I gave a testimony, and I asked all the, so what you can do is you can work your narrative in during the jury selection process, so you can basically ask questions during that jury selection that work into the narrative that you're trying. So I went about it a little underhandedly because they were being underhanded. So they wouldn't allow me to use my defense. So in my jury selection process, I would be like, now if Northrop Grumman were in violation of international law, would you as a U.S. citizen feel this is, well, no, now I haven't used this in my testimony or my defense, but I've already put that seed in the mind of that jury that we're talking about a corporation committing a crime, you know, a war crime, or that, and so that's how I ended up trying to use the best of my ability, the position I was in. And then I got up in my testimony, and continually the prosecutor would say, you know, I just kept on my point, regardless of what they told me I couldn't talk about. And they say, you know, and it was getting to the point where actually I was going to get kicked out of the courtroom because I failed to, because the prosecutor said, objection, irrelevant. Oh, okay. And then you just keep on, you know, and that's one way to do it. But, and that's when there's nowhere else to go. If you're not going to allow me to talk about war crimes being committed, I mean, what are we doing here? So I hope for you the best. Imminent threat is going to be the biggest obstacle.
A group that I was with in the 80s was acquitted using that necessity. And it was a bit of a stretch because we were talking about what was going on in Central America, the atrocities that were occurring there. Death squads trained by our government, and not all of us had been there. Mm-hmm. In your case, you had been there. So in our case, they wouldn't allow testimony from us about what was happening there. Mm-hmm. Because mm-hmm. from those of us who hadn't been there, but we had a CIA agent to come, and that was a different story. His testimony was allowed, and all this information was entered during blood year, and under, as you said, were being selected. So we were acquitted, and it's unclear whether that's because of the necessity defendant or maybe jury nullification.
Mm-hmm.
Either
that's
way, it worked for us at that time. So I'm trying to remember what my question was.
Well, yeah, you mean you can work a lot of that. Like, in my closing argument, I went ahead and said, like, hey, they didn't allow, I told the jury, they didn't allow me to use this defense, and you just say it as quickly as you can because they're going to cut you off, you know? And you're like, hey, and I'm telling you right now that this system is rigged, and this is why, and then they'll say, you know.
Just since you have been there and witnessed these things,
So they should have allowed that.
I agree.
Hi. First of all, I really like what you said about moments of humanity. Because those sparks, like what you did for me and what you've done in this movement, has created moments of humanity for a lot of us. You know, because it's contagious, what you're doing. So, two-part question. Bringing this movement to different communities, how do you engage that? I'm particularly interested in the African-American community and students and young people. And then also, how do we move the divestment movement?
So first part, outreach into other communities. It's been a frustrating road. I think that Iowa City is kind of ahead of the game than most. In Des Moines, so we have Drake University right in our backyard, and we like offer internships and are taken up on them quite often by the students, but they just never seem to really get out of that academic understanding of humanity rather than actually living that. Like even with the Mississippi Stand, we had several Drake students who considered themselves, they self-professed radical anarchists, 18, not to down on that. I was like, great. I was really excited to have that energy come in. I was really like embraced. And during the Mississippi Stand, not a one of them came down. You know, I had hands down more support from folks in Iowa City than I did from folks in my own community, people I lived with, people in the next door, And so I get very frustrated on that level, on that outreach level, and that, and I think that one of the things that I do, like, by default is just focus on action and the contagious effect that it has, rather than, I mean, and it's really, really difficult more and more to be able to go into schools and talk, give talks and stuff like that. When I did international peace work, I'd come back and I'd do a series of like PowerPoint presentations, and more it seemed like universities were boxing myself and other folks out of that opportunity to go into the classroom and tell students about what's going on. Drake University, I mean, we try to get in there to talk to folks about stuff. We, Ruby and I, have leafleted all over the college campuses there, where there's Grandview and Drake. We've talked to people. I don't know if you met Ruby, but her and Alex, they really have me convinced, like, yeah, maybe. Yeah. Like, maybe this will work, you know? We haven't done this in a while because I gave up on it so long ago and we spent, you know, all day, you know, talking to students coming in and out, and some of them even seemed really engaged, like, yeah, not all of them, but some of them were like, oh, yeah, that pipeline, oh, you know, that one, and they only knew about the North Dakota stuff, of course, but that's fine, but it's somewhere to start, and, go ahead. I appreciate what you're saying because I've kind of given up, or I've like at least let it go to the waste. That whole idea of outreach has really gone to the wayside for me because time and time again, just suffering from this, that utter disappointment and like lack of enthusiasm of folks around me, even folks who talk of like, so I hang out with a lot of people who say, hey, who recognize the issue and recognize the problem, but then don't seem to want to act on it. I'm a kind of a singular actor. I found myself most times. And even when Mississippi Stand really got popping and like people showed up, I felt like my job was done. And then you know, do with it what you may. Because I don't know where I fit into that anymore. I guess it is more of a role where I want to initiate, draw attention to, and then move on. I don't. Yes.
So I have a question about nonviolence and how you conduct yourself when you're in situations.
Sure.
And I was reading something you wrote.
Oh, yeah.
Where are you finding this stuff, Erin?
Kind of a worker newsletter.
Oh, okay.
I highly recommend it. So when you're in a situation, when I was in a situation in the 70s, I was shouting and in people's faces. And so what I like about what you wrote, I do it differently now. But what I like about what you wrote is, it ties into the spiritual too, as nonviolence does, especially when you're faced with a threat. You said, one day you found yourself face to face with a Korean police officer.
Oh yeah, that's way back.
The machinery was roaring past you, and she looked at you and she said she was sorry. Remember that?
I do remember that.
And you had this impulse. She said she was performing her duty to keep you safe. And you can take this up anywhere, but your impulse was to say, ask her whether she thought it was safe to live on a militarized island. Since when was the U.S. military ever successful in keeping the people of Korea safe? But instead, you complimented her on how well she spoke English. And she smiled, and you smiled back. Could you talk a little bit about where that comes from and how you make a choice to not be in somebody's face?
Okay, so I think part of it comes from, well, I felt like in that moment, I was building relationships. And there are times to, and you all have seen me, there are times to point out injustices, and there are times where I make people accountable for their actions and their words. And I do it all the time. But there are also times when you're in a foreign country, talking to seemingly a superior, when maybe just we can be human right now. Like maybe just you're on that side and you know I'm on this side and we both know who's side, you know, we're standing on. But can we just stop hating each other for a moment and be human? And I'm not gonna affirm your excuses. I'm just doing my job. I don't want to do that. I don't want to. I think one of the reasons I can handle police officers so eloquently is because my father worked 30 years for the Dallas County Sheriff's Department, and we had cops around a lot. And even though there are all sorts of scandals that have happened in that county, and I am not unaware at how police officers are abusing their power often, and not doing what's right, and are playing to their immediate boss rather than the really important one up there. I will hold folks accountable on various levels, but sometimes in those moments, you know, while I'm not gonna let you think that you're doing the right thing, I'm still gonna try to meet you on some basic level where maybe tomorrow we can have a real conversation. You know what I mean? Maybe because I met you on that level, tomorrow we can talk about what's really going on here without you being so defensive and so guarded about what it is you're doing. You're just going to remember that girl gave me a compliment. And tomorrow you're not going to be so angry. with me. And maybe we can actually start building a bridge here rather than tearing it down. That one was from many years ago.
How about Palestine? How does that work in Palestine?
Palestine's a little different. That's military with guns in your face. And I had a similar experience, though, in Palestine when I was being arrested. I did third party accompaniment at 7 o'clock. Okay. But I did third party accompaniment, and I was, I was kicked out of Palestine also, out of the West Bank. I'm not allowed back for 10 years. But I was being arrested by a group of Israeli military, and I remember having this moment of like human interaction with the men who were arresting me. I was in the back of their like whatever military jeep thing, and I was handcuffed, and he honestly looked back at me and said, "Why are you here? Like, you're an American. What are you doing here? You have everything you want. Why are you coming over here and doing this?" And I said, "Well, you know, if that farmer had been you, I'd be doing the same thing. I mean, like, it's not about staying comfortable in my little world when my taxpayer dollars bought that gun you're waving around in my face. I have an accountability now." And I think that if I had just been like, "F you, screw you, da 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 da," we never would have been able to actually have that conversation, because I know that got him thinking, like, "Oh, you would do this for me too?" I mean, yeah. I mean, like, anybody who's oppressed and oppressed with the weaponized systems that I'm used to. I don't pay my taxes anymore, but this is all video recorded. Oh, geez. But I have an accountability now. But I also have accountability to you on a human level. Like, you are a human being. I am a human being. We have now found ourselves in these roles. And I believe in what I'm doing. Do you? And you just ask it. Do you? Because they just don't.
Okay. The
word eminent struck me. And, maybe you could say, yes, it is an imminent threat because I'm using the same definition as the U.S. government legal advice to drone, for drone use. You know, we can only use killing drones when the threat is imminent. But the definition of imminent means when it's not imminent.
Yeah,
yeah,
exactly. Yeah, exactly. I agree. They can try that, maybe. Or I'll try it next time.
Let's give Jessica, we're going to stop. If you wanted to ask her another question, maybe you can do it privately. Maybe you can stick around for a few minutes. Is that okay? But I have to tell you, she motivated me to get arrested, which I never thought I'd do. So it's all due to you.
Oh, man.
Let's give her a big hand.